Our next two speakers have come all the way from the Netherlands, if I'm correct, from Utrecht, for today and for tomorrow. The recon team became aware of these guys' work about a year and a half ago. That's my data viz high-tech system. And we had a part of their work formed a part of our hack day this year, and we're extremely keen to actually get Jack and Joan here in person, which thankfully they agreed to do. And this is a different sheet that I have. Their talk is of shapes and style visualizing innovations in scholarly communication. You guys.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having us here across the divide. So, probably all of you found some snippets of paper on your chair, and wondered what to do with that. Anyone has an idea on what it actually is? What is on these snippets? There are some words. What do they stand for? Sorry.
Slogans.
Slogans. Yeah.
Complete sentences.
Any more ideas on what they might relate to?
Something in Japanese.
Addictions.
Responses to a questionnaire.
That's a good one. Technically, that's completely correct. But if you look at these, this is actually the full community of researchers globally that's inside the room right now. So you've got some examples of what they think. So this is really answers to the question. And what we would like you to do right now is something that you weren't allowed at school, which is talk. So what we would like you to do is to talk to your neighbor or to the person sitting behind you or in front of you, so you can even turn around. And what we would like you to do is to discuss whether there's any connection between the two things that are on your two papers. So with two persons, see if there's a connection between these two things.
Big fans of open access, open data.
Sure.
Oh, sorry, my friend. Yes.
Yeah.
It's
gone.
It's okay. So we're both big fans of open access and open data. And then we were discussing, I suggested, well, maybe that will make it harder for people to post fraudulent results if they're having to publish their data. But then I suddenly realized, well, no, they will just fake the data. And then we'll have fake data published. And then we'll have the whole problem of, do we need tool sets to look at data sets to see whether they've been fraudulently generated or not? So yes, that's an unpleasant, that's a dark pattern.
Yes. So if you're a developer, there's a business opportunity there. Anyone else? Anyone on this side of the room who wants to share what you discussed?
You're too sharp.
So, I mean, we had a discussion, so Graham had emergence and acceptance of new forms of packaging of research output, and I had increased use of social media as a peer review distribution mechanism. And so I actually thought with his, the phrase that he had, that really exemplified actually something I put in my talk about. I had brain images in three dimensions, and putting it into a paper form is not the most conducive way to share that. So by packaging it in a different way, like maybe in more videos and allowing people to link to that type of thing, that would have been more useful for me.
Great, worked well. Anyone who couldn't have a discussion between two people because you had no idea what it said on your card? I heard some...
This is in Chinese.
Exactly, there's one in Chinese. Well, that's a challenge. I mean, if you're a scientist, if you research, if you collaborate, it's a challenge, the language divide. It's an issue. So these are just some of the things that real people, real scientists, real researchers think about the future of scholarly communication.
And of course, this is really very chaotic data. We have got over 10,000 of these. We didn't print them all. Over 10,000 of these from across the world. This is chaotic data. We're trying to find patterns in these. And that's why we set up this project, to find out what's behind all the chaos that's been happening in scholarly communication.
And we'll be telling you about that today. And we'll focus also on the choices in visualization we made while working on this project, and what kind of impact that had for us in doing this project. So I want to start with one of the first things we did in this project that resulted in this figure that sort of started to lead a life of its own, that I'm really happy with. And that was, it really started about 1.5-2 years ago on a Friday afternoon after work. All these new tools, all these new developments that researchers can use, we should make a list of those. So at the end of the afternoon, we had a little piece of paper. We had a list of about 10 to 20 tools. We put that into an Excel sheet. It grew. We decided, okay, they can be used for different phases in the research cycle. So we made different columns. And it's very basic spreadsheet. It's very useful, but it's not really nice to go out into the world with that. So we decided to make that into something that was visually appealing and that could really give the impression of what's happening, all the new tools that are developing. And that's why we made this one. So our first choice was to divide it by the phases of the research cycle, from discovery to analysis to writing to publication, outreach and assessment. And then our second choice was using colors. We talked a bit earlier today, several people talked about the use of colors. And I'm not good at color palettes. I'm really bad at deciding which colors go well together. So I did a bit of digging on the internet. And I found actually in a style guide of the Dallas Morning News, the American newspaper, they had very specific colors that they use in all their visualizations. And if you look at the ones on the bottom, you may recognize them. Because I was looking for 6 colors that would go well together. And the interesting thing is that someone in the audience said earlier today that color, some of those colors are really drab colors. And thank you. We'll increase the contrast a bit. Also heard that's important. So some of these may be really drab colors that I wouldn't have chosen on my own as a color, but I think on the whole they work quite well together. So basically use what's out there, use what other people have thought of, and then attribute that. Another thing that I really liked about this style book, when I looked it up earlier this week to give this talk, was that they explicitly say here that color palette is not just a rule. Colors are essential to build a family structure to the graphics. Use these colors in everything you do. And that's exactly what we did. We use these colors in all our outreach, and you'll see some more examples of that. And that really ties the whole project together. That really gives it a feel of a connected whole. And it also said, to create variations, use saturation. Okay, so that's what we did. And in our circle figure, we used three gradients of these colors. We used them to denote a timeline. So if you look at the tools in a minute, you'll see that they start in the middle and then go out. Newer tools appear on the outside. And this also gave us a nice color palette to use in all our different outings. Because sometimes you want a lighter color, sometimes a darker color, but it still really ties in together. So that's about the circle shape and the color. And then we could have put all the names of the tools in. And that would have been one mess of small prints, and no one could make sense of that. So we decided to add the logos. Because the logos, they're always a very visual image of a tool. They're instantly recognizable in most instances. And it also means it was a lot of work. Because we made them transparent. I know a lot about making things transparent in PowerPoint now. So we have a huge collection of all different iterations of these logos. And another thing we noticed while collecting all these logos, that predominantly, apparently, blue is a really popular color if you are designing a logo for a scholarly communication tool. And I wonder, listening to the talk of Isaac just before the break, whether all these companies did A/B testing with their logos in green and in blue and decided blue's best. So that's how a little bit of the story, backstory of how we got to this image. But in the end, it's not about the image, it's about developments in scholarly communication. We inventorized all these different tools. More than these are the 101, the 101 tools that at the time they came to market were innovative. Really changed the way you could do research, you could do science. And from these, we were looking at this, and then we thought, well, you could maybe envision people using combinations of tools in different ways of working. Maybe. So go to hypothetical workflows. Maybe some people use predominantly traditional tools, tools that are basically just the same as in the age of print. Only now they're online, but you can basically do the same as in the age of print and not much more. And these are all tools that are probably very familiar to all of you. There are also tools that are a bit more modern, that make use of the scale and the linking abilities of the internet to make work, to make your workflow more powerful, more modern tools. Going one step further, what we dubbed innovative tools, they really change the way you can do science, you can do research. For instance, using Mendeley as a discovery tool, not only is not just a big database of papers that you can search based on keywords, but it also makes use of the social media aspect. It also looks at what papers other people have favorited or have selected to give you suggestions about what to read. So it adds an extra layer to that discovery. So those tools that really add something extra to the way you work, we dub them the innovative tools. And then for people who are really like to experiment and like to really be on the cutting edge of scholarly communication, there are new tools that are really doing things much differently, using new technology, potentially have a big impact on changing the way we work, but at the same time, and it won't go for all of these because many of these have now in 1.5 year time really establish themselves. But some of them in this category, they might make it, or they might disappear, or they might inspire other people to build on them. We just don't know yet. Sort of the bleeding edge of scholarly communication. So our hypothesis was that people choose certain tools, and maybe you can characterize the way people work by looking at the tools they use. But of course, people can choose anything. But companies, organizations, also more and more try to support researchers in all the phases of the workflow and try to offer tools to support people in all those phases. Google actually supports a lot of those research phases. Google Scholar for discovery, Google Books, Google Drive, Google Sheets for analysis, Google Drive for writing, Google Scholar for outreach for your research profile, and also for assessment, for metrics. And the big unknown is whether Google will at some point also become a publication platform. When will we see Google Science? Same for the big publishers. For an example here, Nature Publishing Group Macmillan, at the time we put this out, also already had tools for all these research phases. And this is something that keeps on developing. Of course, Nature fused with Springer, so now the Nature suite of tools, the Nature Macmillan ecosystem, is now the Nature Springer Macmillan ecosystem and has expanded. And you can make the same figure of Elsevier that, as of Mike's talk this morning, we had to quickly update to include Hivebench, and now it really serves the whole research cycle. Well, before, we had a big question mark here as well. So that's what we're seeing, that publishers, big companies, are actively acquiring tools to really offer researchers the whole suite of tools. And then the question is, as a researcher, are you going to buy into that? Are you going to make your own decisions? Are you going to pick and choose? What kind of decisions do you make? And that's what really interests us. So we put all this together, big circle, the workflows. We put this on a poster for Force 11 last year in January. And we also included another part of this poster, which I put up here a bit bigger. For the people who were in the pub last night, this is our hard-to-read slide.
Sure.
Don't bother reading this. But what it says is this, based on all these tools, you can think of things that are happening in scholarly communication. What are the big questions? What are the big developments? What are the big challenges that we see in each of these phases of the research cycle? And again, we use the same colors as in our big wheel to make it recognizable that it's part of the same project. And it makes it easy to go back and forth between the two. And so there's a lot going on. There are many developments. But maybe the overarching development, overarching all of this, is that while before those phases might have been really separate, going first to discovery, then doing your analysis, then writing, then publishing, now is much more complicated research cycle. It's a multi-ordered research cycle, as we call it, because it's now possible to take shortcuts. You don't have to go through this cycle all in once. You don't do that anyway, because you will iterate within the cycle. You will do multiple rounds of analysis, multiple rounds of writing. You will go in between these phases. When your paper is rejected, you go back to the writing stage, maybe even go back to the analysis stage and then try again. But interestingly, it becomes easier and easier now with more online tools to also not wait until after you've finished your research to publish. You can publish in your preparation phase when you have a good idea. You can publish that. You can publish your analysis even before you publish your paper. Put your protocols online, your methods online. Assessment can also be done if we include peer review. In that, peer review is no longer limited only to the publication phase. That can also be done later by post-publication peer review. After the paper is published, other people can review your paper. So basically, online tools now make it possible to make this a much more complex and flexible research cycle with many more possibilities.
So it really has become a complex picture. And the question is how to make this more simple, how to understand it, how to get a grasp of all what's going on. So let's try to make it more simple. Let's try to, quote Louis van Gaal, I know you love him, as he always says, well, as we in the Netherlands say, how to make chocolate of it. So let's try to make chocolate of it. There is big complexity, but there is another way that helps you see what's really going on and what choices you have as a researcher. in when you're configuring the way you work, when you're choosing what tools to use, what framing do you have for that? What will be the basis of your choice? So we make this model, which we call the geo model, which I like because I'm a geographer. And it's a triangle, which is also nice because it's another shape than just, again, the same circle. So what's actually in this triangle? The way you can look at tools, you earlier showed that we made a topology from traditional tools to modern to innovative and to experimental tools. You can also look at tools from another angle, at what these tools mean for the way you carry out your research. Do you want to use efficient tools? Do you want to use open tools? Or do you want to use good tools? Or to make it a little bit more important, actually, in its effect, what effect do you want to have with the way you are doing your research? Do you want to be just efficient? Do you want to which is always nice, save time, save money, grow kudos, get your H index up? Do you want to be more open with your research? Or do you want to be good? And good, I will come back to that, what that means, because I'm seeing some eyebrows that are raised, and I will answer them later on. So, but first look at open. What does that mean? Well, open means a way of working that includes, for instance, open peer review, or opening up your lab notes, letting others profit from that while you are working on them. But also things like using plain language, not just the very difficult to understand technical papers, but making a translation of that in plain language abstracts, or by blogging, or by explaining your research in live events like these. And things like open drafting, which really go way further, like so that other people can read while you are writing. But also, which is also already quite mainstream, things like open access and having open licenses. And many of these things, not all of them, but many of these things have to do with business models of publishers and with copyright changes and economic changes. When you look at the other angle, so the angle that almost no one has problem with, although some publishers have difficulty implementing this, is being very efficient in the way you publish, the way you do your scholarly communication. And that means using tools that, for instance, are very well connected, that are interoperable, or tools that really don't have the limitations copied from the printed world to the online world, so tools that don't have two columns of text that you have to swipe your screen all the time, tools that have very, very fast, for instance, a fast speed of publication, that you don't wait for another issue, you don't wait for the full peer review to be done before you get your text out. But also technical things like very good semantic discovery. We think that Scopus or Google Scholar or Mendeley are good at this, but actually, if you ask the experts, we're still just very much at the beginning of doing very good contextual discovery. Things like reusability and versioning, other technical things that might speed up your work and might also make it more efficient. And that has to do with all kinds of standards and technical changes, really getting the full possibilities out of the internet, out of all the technical standards that we have, the XML, etc. Then, turning to that strange word good, what does that mean? Well, that is anything that relates for us, and we like to have the G of good, because of geo, but anything that relates to doing research that is replicable, that produces, that gives you reproducible results, being transparent, but also things having to do with attribution and fair crediting of people who have contributed to your work, with all kinds of mechanisms that avoid fraud or plagiarism, not just checks, but things that avoid happening, that these things happen in the first place, So that's anything that has to do with making research more reliable, more reproducible. And that's a little bit more difficult, a little bit more depending on culture, depending on incentives people have to do this. It has to do with governance, how things are organized within a certain discipline. And many stakeholders have to act together to make this happen, and every stakeholder has its own reasons for being slow or being more modern, being more innovative and faster in doing these kinds of things. So this is how you can understand what's going on, and this is also how you can frame your own usage of tools. If I switch from EndNote to Mendeley, what does this do with the way I'm working? And if I switch to Zotero again, what does that do? So there are all kinds of questions that can be answered by using this simple model. Well, simple, actually, it has become quite complex again. Sorry about that. But really, to know what's really going on, we have to do research at a more granular level. This is just all very meta and theoretical. And to see what's going on and also what's possible, we have to dive into those tools. And we're constantly talking about tools. Of course, that is a bit of a reduction of the complexity by looking at tools, but we see it as a very good proxy for what might be going on in scholarly communication. Of course, you lose some of the complexity and some of the intricacies of what's going on, but it makes it easier to study, and it also makes it easier to communicate. So we made this big list of tools. We adopted the 400 plus tools and innovations in scholarly communication, which is a nice title. A title starting with a number are always nice because they are up in the list, but pointing it down to a specific number is very stupid, of course, because by now it's almost 800. The plus is nice. That's technically correct. It's still 400 plus, but otherwise it's a stupid title. So what does this list give you? This list gives you really hundreds and hundreds of tools that you can use in all phases of your research workflow. So we have these 7 major phases. We have 6 of them in our circle, but there is a preparation phase where you're looking for funding, etc., and doing some project management, etc. These are the 6 main phases, but you can really split that up in really more concrete activities that you are carrying out when doing research. So for instance, within publication, you can separate archiving code from archiving data, archiving publications, archiving presentations, and there are separate tools for each of those activities. And it goes all the way down to doing your outreach, to commenting and doing peer review, perhaps even post-pub peer review by commenting on stuff that others did, that have put their text, their papers already online, measuring impact and doing assessment or being assessed. So this is really a very targeted, very concrete actions in the research workflow. And we do have this database available. It's actually quite ugly, but it's very simple. It's just a big Google spreadsheet that anyone can add to. By the way, if you go in, you can add your own tool if you're a tool developer, or if you use something that you think that should be there. And it gives you some basic information on for what kind of activity you can use that, when this tool was developed, etc. And it really has become a very big list. It's useful, and you can link to it, you can send people to it. We do have our own list, which is not published, which is a little bit bigger, but which has some variables of all these tools that are not complete yet. We have names of developers and whether it's a commercial tool or an open source tool or whatever, and we're trying to make that complete, and also trying to make this a little bit more professional. We're getting into contact with other makers of lists of tools, because there are various types of those lists. So it should be improved, but it's a lot of work. But if you look, we found that every month we added dozens of tools to those lists. So we were thinking of, let's make a graph of that. Let's visualize the growth of the number of tools. And that's this one. From 1994, so over the last 20 plus years to 2015, you really see an amazing growth after, say, 2006, 2007. Actually, we were a little bit late in science with using the full possibilities of openness, of internet, of Web 2.0, Web 3.0, etc. But in the end, we saw really an explosion of the number of tools becoming available, especially in outreach, in analysis, in publication, and also in discovery. Not so much in things like assessment, not so much in things like writing, where you have really standards that are very broadly accepted and people don't really move away from those, and new tools that are coming available are not successful and die off again. Of course, we made this half a year ago. There is a little bit of a drop off at the end. That doesn't mean for sure that it really is going down. We should do the same analysis again at the end of this year. If you look at that at another way, you already can see that really an avalanche of tools growing from 2010 to 2015. So these are really new tools that became available in each of those years, for those 30 activities in the research cycle. And the size of the bubbles here is just one indicator that we happen to have available, which is the number of Twitter followers. Of course, that you can have a full presentation about whether that's useful or not, and all the caveats you should be aware of. But it's a nice indication of really the take-up and whether something is hotly debated, whether people really share the idea of using a new tool with each other. That is reflected in the number of Twitter users. And finally, you can also see, if you really look closely at those data, what are the tools that really grew very fast during a certain period. So we looked at the last half year of 2015, and you can find out what are the tools that are really hot, that really saw their number of Twitter followers double or more than double in those 6 months. Of course, it's nothing compared to some famous people, Kardashians, or you name them, that really explode at a certain moment when they become available, or film stars or pop stars. But these are the more or less the stars of scholarly communication, supported by tools of the last of those 6 months last year. So this again is also for us another way to raise interest in what's going on. Actually, it's not really in the end about the tools, but it's for what they stand for whether they indeed make research or have the possibility in them to make research more efficient or more open or more reproducible, more good, so better.
And these examples, just a few graphs, they also show again what we talked about earlier, connecting elements, using the same colors for the same phases, recognizable, and also shows a bit of diversity in what we chart out ourselves, what graph types work, what graph types are being received and retweeted, what works and what doesn't. So it's also a reflection of our own experimentation in visualization. Using Twitter as a measure of uptake of tools is just one measure with a lot of caveats, as Jeroen already said. But it is something that we are really interested in, because looking at the supply side of tools says something about where the perceived gaps are, where people feel the need to make a new tool. But making a tool is one thing, people have to use it. So we are really interested in the demand side of all these tools and what that stands for. We want to know what tools do researchers use in all kinds of different disciplines, different countries, PhD students versus professors, as many as possible. So that's why last year we started our big online survey, asking people exactly that. And again here, which is sort of the running line for everything we do, we focused on the visual aspects of it. We decided not to do a SurveyMonkey survey with lots of text, but really make it visual, easily recognizable, and hopefully also easy to do, and maybe even fun to do. So what we did, think back on the big spreadsheet that Jeroen showed with the 31 research activities. We chose 17 of these research activities throughout the cycle that we thought were the most important. Again, if we had chosen all 30, I bet 80% of people would never have finished the survey, so we limited. And for those 17 activities, we made a multiple choice, a pick and choose menu for each activity, listing 7 tools by just their, again, their logos, easily recognizable, visual, and asking people, what tools do you use for this activity? People could choose any of these tools, and we made sure to include big ones, really well-known ones, but also, for every question, some lesser-known ones, some smaller ones, to pique people's interest and to really make people think about the other tools rather than the big obvious ones that they might also use. Because for each question, we also had the "and also other" options. If people click that, they could enter the tools that they used that were not listed here. And luckily, a lot of people did. So we put this out as an online survey and tried to distribute it as widely as possible. Starting with Twitter, starting small, seeing what the uptake was, seeing whether our behind-the-scenes workflow actually worked and didn't collapse. And then afterwards, we scaled up a bit, and we also tried to reach people who might not be on social media, because that's an inherent bias if you start out that way. So one thing we did, we collaborated with a lot of institutions where people, where universities, but also publishers, they distributed the survey amongst all their researchers, or in the case of the publishers, all their authors and editors. And that way we hoped we could reach a larger variety of people who might not see the survey only if it's on social media or online. And we also used mailing lists to distribute it, so quite a different, many different approaches. And to reach as many people as possible, don't limit to English. We talked earlier with the cards. Other languages. We had the survey available in 6 other languages: Chinese, Japanese, Russian, French, Spanish, and Arabic. To enable also people outside the Anglo-Saxon world and outside the Anglo-Saxon language region to participate. And again, going with the visual theme, we wanted to also make it fun for people to participate and also make it useful for people to participate. So anyone who participated and who opted to do so, no one was obliged to fill out their email address, but if people did and indicated they wanted to, they got some feedback from us. And again, not a list of tools that they use, because they know that, because they just filled that in.
And no Amazon vouchers.
Exactly.
Yeah, I did it twice by mistake.
Yeah, we know. Bad brain. So you received 2 of these. Maybe, were these the 2 you received? No, I hope not. These are 2 examples of the feedback people received. And what we did here was, again, for the different phases in the research cycle, that you just filled out all the tools you use, indication on of your tool usage, how that was on the scale of traditional, modern, innovative, experimental, that we talked about before. So people could be rather traditional, modern in a couple of phases and maybe not do anything in the other phases. That's the first example. The red line is the individual, and the gray diamond is the average of their peer group. And for peer group, we looked at research roles. So postdocs were compared with other postdocs. Same for PhD students, professors, and other groups. And you see a very nice variety. For instance, this person is more, well, now this is tricky, because we really don't want to say that being traditional is less than being more innovative or experimental. Far from that. I mean, there are very good reasons to use the traditional tools. It really depends on your what type of research you do, what kind of things you feel important, just, it's the way you are, and there's nothing inherently wrong with that. But you can see how you relate to your peers. And that's what we try to give people back, just as a visual thing, as visual feedback of the survey. And of course, going with the language team, people who filled out the survey in Japanese got the feedback back in Japanese. So in the end, we got over 20,000 respondents, which is really good because we're not only interested in a big bulk, we really want to drill down into different disciplines. And you can see we had a nice spread of disciplines, social sciences, physical sciences, life sciences. The only group really lagging here was the law people. So for some reason or another, just didn't reach enough law people. For research role, almost 75% of our respondents were researchers, either at the faculty level, professors, PhD students, or postdocs. And then we had some smaller groups of publishers, librarians, people from industry and government. And of course, the also always present other group. Sorry, this one. But we also asked, okay, what do you do? So we know what these people do. Quite some citizen scientists in that group, which is really interesting in and of itself. And to be able to differentiate across career stage, because especially in this group, professors, assistant professor, associate professor, full professor, emeritus professor, that's a big range. To be able to differentiate a bit in that, we also asked for year of first scholarly publication. Again, we didn't want to ask for age. We didn't want to discourage people from filling out that information. So we thought year of first scholarly publication was a nice objective measurement for that parameter. And again, there's a nice spread. How about geography? And this is our TED Talk slide, map of the world. So again, darker colors, more responses relative to as a measure for the number of researchers, because if a country has more researchers, you expect a higher response. As a proxy for that, we used gross domestic product to get some idea, to get some measure to hold it against, because numbers for researchers, they are available, but not for all disciplines, and are really unreliable. So we used GDP as a proxy for that. And you can see that we got a healthy response from most Western European countries. Also from Russia and South America, which we could really trace back to those language versions of the survey. Conversely, despite our best intentions with the languages, we got really moderate response again from China and Japan also a bit. So there are some white spots, but overall we had a nice distribution across countries. I think we had over 150 countries represented in total. So a lot of data. And we could sit on these data. We could just lock ourselves in for half a year and do some analysis. And it would be just a fraction of what's possible with these data. And our choices might not be the choices you would use in analyzing these data. Those might not be the questions that publishers might have for these data, or research administrators at your university. They might not be the questions you have as a PhD student for these data. Just asking yourself, where do I stand in comparison to my peers? So, I'm just gonna skip this for now. We decided to make these data open as possible. We shared the data set on Zenodo. We made a data publication that was also mentioned this morning, just describing the methodology of the survey and what's in the data. Not doing any analysis, just describing what's out there as a data publication in F1000 Research. And for analysis of the data, we made them available in a dashboard that some of the figures that I just show you are from, and Jeroen will show some more in a minute. The dashboard really makes it easy to look at the results in graph form, filter them for your own population or your country of interest, and without having to dive into a spreadsheet or a CSV sheet with 20,000 rows, really do quick and easy analysis and comparison. For those people who do want to help us with more thorough analysis, we also have put put our data out in a way that you can actually share your R scripts or your Python scripts. And so collaboratively do more analysis on that. We'll come back to that in a minute because that's really interesting for the hack day tomorrow. But some examples of what the dashboard can do and some more examples of what the server can tell.
And for that, I'm going to do a little bit of live demonstration. But first, I'm going to do that immediately. Let's see. So this is the website that we use for the dashboard. It's on a platform called Silk, which is
totally cool.
Which is nice, which is a Dutch company. And what you can do there is just put your data there and make simple, attractive visualizations. So what we did, and I'm going to stand on this side, is of course have this same overview you already saw. But what you can do there is for each of the research activities, dive into them in those six major phases and just look what's going on. For instance, for tools that people can use for sharing data and code, we've put some up here, even a nice European Union one. And you can compare just very simple frequencies of the answers. And as you can see, there are a lot of filters here. You can filter by anything you want. Not going to do that because sometimes it takes a little bit long and you have to wait for that. And we just got a warning that we have 10 minutes. And we split it out, this out on purpose for the seven answers that were preset, that were given to people, and the also other option that people really have the possibility to mention anything, because they are in terms of numbers they are incomparable. You can't, it would not be wise and actually not advisable to make one list of them, because it takes much more effort to give an and also other option and specify that than just clicking a certain tool. So we encourage you to dive into that and look at those data yourselves. Let's see, where am I? This one. So that this is the dashboard. And what you can also see on the dashboard, if you dive in, but we make it simple for you here, is what we ask people also, apart from all these activities for which they can use certain tools. We just wanted to have a few control variables, and so we asked for, do you support, in general, open access? And do you support, in general, open science? And these are really quite quite nice numbers. Of course, there may be a difference between saying, well, yes, I support them, and really doing it, which takes more effort and could affect your career positively or negatively, or you might get uncertain about that, but this is a nice basis. And of course you can get all the details of also of those preferences for open access and open science and make maps like this for open access and open science, and you can see some different patterns. But you can also see that Britain is not very much unlike some of the other countries in the European Union. But this is interesting because you can compare and do analysis and see what, if people say that they support open science, does that reflect in the tools they use, for instance, for publication? So a tool for publication might be a certain type of journal. What we already also asked, of course, what you also can find out from this survey is actually, do people like to use all these tools? Can I ask you, has anyone got an idea of how many different tools an average researcher uses?
20.
Do we think that's about it? Anyone thinks it's much more?
40.
Yeah. Anyone thinks that's an exaggeration and it should be much less?
should be much less, but it doesn't happen.
Okay, it should be much less, but it isn't. Okay, let's have a look.
So this is a nice bell curve of what they use, and you will see that the median is about 22. But there are researchers that use a lot more, and if we would add librarians, they would be even further out here. Some of them, the crazy people. This is not, it's actually quite concentrated and quite a good average, not so big deviation from the mean. So again, we have asked for all these research activities, and I should move on. I already showed you this one. Go on with this one. What's very interesting also, even before you do very thorough analyses, is that even the number of responses that we get on all these questions tells what people are doing. So everyone is using tools to search and to write, but only a few people use tools, for instance, to do peer review outside what the journal has organized. For instance, through Papir or registering things on Publons or things like that, or share their notebooks, or archive and share their data. This already tells something about what's going on. Another nice thing is that what we did is use a website to share those scripts. And that's Kaggle. If you don't know it, I advise you to dive in. Kaggle is a nice site where people can put the data sets and have really a big community of people that just love to do analyses on whatever kind of data. And they can put in their R code, put in their Python, put in their Julia code, I don't even know what that is and cannot render that kind of code. But what you see if you put your data on there, that people will start playing with that. And that's very useful. There is discussion, and you can see the top contributors on your data, and you don't know those people, but they are doing useful people with your data. For instance, creating a Kaggle script, a script on Kaggle like this with that outcome, and also so the scripts are on Kaggle, the outcomes are on Kaggle. You can reuse, you can fork, and you can do whatever you want on Kaggle with those data. And that's very instructive and useful, and people can profit from that. But there are further possibilities.
Yes. Especially, you saw already on Kaggle, this heat map, comparing how tools are used together. That's one area we want to explore in our further analysis. Look at what tools are used together. Are there tools that specifically are used more together than you would expect, maybe? Or tools that are used less often together than you would expect based on probability. That's something I want to know more of, and I really want to maybe ask you, room full of PhD researchers, people who are familiar with this kind of analysis, maybe because you look at gene expression, upregulation of gene expression, a lot of these figures about. Make these with our data. We would love to see people use our data for this. This is also our reflection of the visualize early and often that Ian talked about earlier. These are some of the more ugly examples, maybe. Just try out to relate how tools are used together. And again, the Sankey diagram that was mentioned. This is a Sankey diagram. Looking at tools, traditional, modern, innovative, experimental. How do tools, people using traditional tools for discovery, what kind of tools do they use for analysis and all through the research cycle? It's another avenue that we might explore, that you might be interested to explore. Network visualization. Tried a bit with that. Of course, all the tools are connected because there is, within 20,000 people, there's bound to be someone who uses one of those tools with one of the other tools. So we really have everything connected. But the connection, some tools are used much more often together. So you can do some clustering. And you can see clusters of tools that are used often together. You see, again, too small to read for most of it. But this is a cluster really highlighting, to my surprise, some of the R, there's R in there, LaTeX is there, MATLAB is in there, but also Wikipedia and Google Scholar Alerts and Google Scholar Citations. Apparently people use that together. And very interesting, for Mendeley, It comes out as a cluster of its own. People who use Mendeley for one research activity predominantly or selectively also use Mendeley for other research activities, which is something we might hypothesize, but the data really shows that those clusters are there, they're real. Many uses for our data. We put up some of our own ideas for analysis in a GitHub issue list that we might want to invite you tomorrow if you want to work with us on that during the hack day to do that. Like we did for the Mozilla Science Sprint, and we hope to do that tomorrow for the hack day. But it's not everyone who might be interested in that. Again, people can use these data for any way you want. As a researcher, you might be interested to know how you relate to other people in your area, other PhD students in your own area. How people in Britain relate to people elsewhere. You can use the dashboard for that. And even if you don't want to dive into the data, the main message maybe even to get across is experiment. We knew half of these tools before we started, but in doing this project, we really learned to use a lot of these tools and gained a lot more skills. And that's something that I want to invite all of you to try out and do that. Thank you.
Okay, we've got time for a couple of questions before we move on.
So, very early on, you showed another version of your circular plot with amounts of rising popularity for new tools. And I noticed GitLab was in there.
Yeah.
Now that was around, so that this was late 2015.
Yeah.
That was from?
Over Christmas.
Yeah, so I'm curious about what data was being shown there exactly.
Those were number of Twitter followers over the last 6 months.
Okay.
So we started number of Twitter followers for the GitLab Twitter account.
Right.
In July, in August, in September, all the way up to December,
okay.
And then the biggest rise in that. If you compare the number in December to the number in July, what the biggest rise was in that for each individual research activity.
Okay, right. That was interesting because GitLab did have a bit of exposure that was perhaps a negative, but
mm-hmm.
the number of Twitter followers
yep.
usually corresponds with any exposure.
Exactly,
so.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Right. I wonder whether any institutions have used your survey technology to profile their researchers so that you know, get a handle on whether they're ahead of the curve, behind the curve, or innovative, or whatever.
Yes, we do. As Bianca said, we did have a lot of partners helping us in distributing the survey, and what they got back from us is their own data. So the data of their researchers. For instance, our own university, in Utrecht, but there are many others. So right now in Utrecht, we do talk to the dean and vice chancellor, etc., about what we see for the kind of patterns we see for their Utrecht University researchers, and it might drive decisions on what tools to license, or it might drive policies by the library on what to do support and training for, or any other kind of questions that on policies and licenses can be answered by diving into those data. So yes.
And is the survey closed now?
Yes, it is. It has been open for 9 months and we closed it in February this year.
And what next for your project?
Well, a lot of analysis, for sure. And the big part of the analysis we didn't even mention in here, but that goes back to your cards. We've got 10,000 free text answers, what people say they think is important, which will be very interesting to analyze. But also, going back to these people, these are basically just counts of what people use. We can make some inferences about the reasons why people use these tools, the reasons why they choose specific way of working above another way of working, motivations for change. But to really get a grip on that, we need to talk to people. So that's our next, after the analysis phase, that will be the next phase in our research, because we ask people, they could volunteer their email address for the feedback, and they could also specifically indicate whether or not they wanted to be contacted for follow-up discussion. And a lot of people said they would, so we've got a nice user base of people across disciplines, countries, career stages to contact to do that follow-up research. So that will hopefully be next.
And actually, ideas for that follow-up question that we could ask them, we try to crowdsource them. So if you have any ideas on what to ask that big chunk of thousands of people that want to talk to us about scholarly communication, what to ask them? What's important? What don't we know yet about how researchers are working and what drives their way of working?
Okay, thank you guys. If I can just say that in essence that's part one. If we're coming to the Hackney tomorrow, part two.
Yes.
Thank you very much guys for coming.